Around the World with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor. We're right here in Boston, Massachusetts at the American Academy of Neurology 69th Annual Meeting. And that's why I'm so happy to be joined here by a local favorite, Dr. James Stankiewicz, who is Clinical Director of the Partners MS Center. We just came out of a session where we heard different presentations, and actually you had the esteemed honor of actually kind of summarizing what those presentations were. Can you give those of us at home kind of an idea of what we heard?
Well, it's a little hard to summarize, but I would say that there were a couple different domains that we sort of looked at. There was an abstract that was presented about cognitive impairment and driving in multiple sclerosis, showing that patients that on visual spatial recall test that did not do well could be at risk for being failing a driving test or even potentially getting in an accident. And so the neurologist should keep this in mind when ordering these tests and potentially screen patients further if they perform poorly on that. Another domain that we looked at was dimethyl fumarate and the risk that patients may experience when lymphocyte counts, which are a type of white blood cell, go down. And we sort of just talked about overall risk profile. It turns out that if patients are below 500 for a significant period of time, they may be at risk for having infections, serious infections. And so we should think about discontinuing patients in that setting. And I did kind of a more broad summary along those lines. A third thing that I spoke about was looking at some of the second generation drugs. So there's a drug that's in trial right now called ofatumumab, and considering it against what's currently available, ocrelizumab, which are both B-cell monoclonal therapies. As some of your audience may know, ocrelizumab was just recently approved. And ofatumumab is going to be a subcutaneous injection, so it's going to go into the skin rather than through an IV. And it may be that it has less of a B-cell depleting effect. A comment that I made was whether or not it just meant that you would have to administer the medicine more frequently, or whether or not it had implications for reducing infection because different areas of storage in the body could be involved. We don't know. We'll have to see in time. And then I guess the last thing that I commented on, what was the last thing that I commented on? I guess, Dan, help me.
It was Ozanimod.
Yeah, so again, just kind of summarizing the trial that was, or the follow-up data that was presented, that the trial and the follow-up data is in line with what you see with fingolimod. Ozanimod is a newer fangled version of this, which may have stimulates receptors slightly differently and may have a more benign profile on the heart, so that people are less likely to get a slowing of the heart rate that we could be worried about. Though, in truth, that is kind of a few and far between effect anyway. So I think that's a pretty reasonable summary of what I talked about at the session.
I want to thank you so much for kind of giving us back home an idea of what we hear about. It's interesting at the sessions, we have not just people presenting, then we have people like you being discussants and actually talking about, and what I thought was really interesting was that presentation from Canada that had to do with driving, you brought together an actual case of yours that had to do with driving as well. And for people with MS, if you have concern about your driving or about your spouse or your care partner's driving, there are things that you can do. So there are driving tests that people can go to. They can go back to the DMV and make sure that things are okay. But I think one of the most important things is we have to make sure that people, no matter what levels of disability, that they're as safe as possible for them as well as for the public around them. I want to thank you so much for joining us, and I want to thank all of you back home.